A very good morning to all of you. We have been talking about the development of cultural studies. At the same time, we talked about the conceptual meaning of cultural studies. So we came to know that cultural studies was established as a center at the Birmingham University, UK, the University of Birmingham. So it was known as the Birmingham Center for Contemporary Cultural Studies, or CCCS. And this particular center was started or established by Richard Hoggart in the year 1964. And later, Hoggart was succeeded by Stuart Hall. And we came to know that cultural studies is the study of how a society creates and shares meaning. Meaning in a sense, we should not understand it as linguistic meaning. Meaning may refer to beliefs, values, cultural behavior, social behavior, etc. So we need to understand that in terms of culture itself. And in a way, it is a kind of interface between the social sciences and the humanities that we understood in the previous lecture. And it is also concerned with the nature of mass culture, culture of the people, and its working of the working of culture in the culture industries. And then we talked about culture industry, which includes popular culture, communication, consumer society, mass media, etc. Further, we understood something about its theoretical framework, its theoretical functioning. It was initially influenced by neo-Marxism. So it adopts what we call Marxist methods of analysis to explore the relationship between cultural forms, which we know as the superstructures, and the base, that is the political economy. And we also came to know something about the background of the British society, political aspects of British society during the 1970s, wherein the working culture was in decline, and industrial industrial progress was at slow, we can say. It was shrinking rather. Despite of this fact, during this period, millions of working class Britons backed the rise of Margaret Thatcher, who represented the Conservative Party. Okay, and this was really antithetical to the interests of the public working class as such. So that was really a matter of surprise and matter of curiosity for the cultural critics. So following Antonio Gramsci, an Italian thinker of 1920s and 30s, the scholars at cultural studies, especially Stuart Hall, etc., started studying this phenomenal change, we can say. So that we need to understand. At the same time, we came to know that cultural studies, an attempt to conceptualize and understand the dynamics of culture. Okay, try to understand the dynamics of culture and try to present it in the form of concepts. You try to understand the relationship between culture and nature, culture and society, high culture and low culture, and the interplay between cultural tradition and cultural differences and diversity. We understood that. Now, in this lecture, we shall be focusing on the principles of cultural studies. These are some of the principles which are at work in cultural studies, and we need to understand that. Okay, we shall go ahead with the discussion on it. Now, these are some of the principles. The first principle of cultural studies is that reality is a social construction. Cultural studies assumes that reality is a social construction. Secondly, it assumes or it works on the principle that identity is a social construction. Further, beliefs are based on perceptions of reality. The fourth principle is that society is marked by a struggle for power. And the fifth principle is that cultural codes create identities for the creator and the receiver. So these are some of the principles that cultural studies takes into consideration while studying culture and its creation of meaning, we can say. It understands how society creates and shares meaning. And these are some of the principles. So we said the first principle is that reality is a social construction. Now, whatever we think is real or reality is not universal as such. It may change from society to society. What we think that something is reality may not be the reality for others. And it is constructed within the social circle, we can say. It is the society which creates the meaning of the things around us. Now, whatever we think is a reality is created by the society. Therefore, I said, whatever is the reality for some people belonging to a particular nation may not be the reality for other nations. For example, our history, we say. Our history is our reality, but that reality may not be the reality for other nations sometimes, especially our neighborhood nations. And when we think about reality in terms of caste, in terms of religion, in terms of region, so it is what we call created by that particular caste, particular community, particular group of people, particular religion, etc. Why? Because these meanings are constructed, they are a perception of reality, not reality itself. Whatever is reality is not reality. That is a perception, the way of looking at the things. And this way of looking at the things is given by our context. We get our perception from the context, from the surrounding that we grow in. Therefore, we need to understand how this reality is defined to understand a particular culture. So, reality has to be understood within that culture. We cannot understand the reality of a given culture by being outside their culture. So, this is how we need to understand. And cultural studies pursue this. It thinks that this is the first principle that it should understand. Secondly, it thinks that, you know, somebody is other. Suppose we think about others. Now, what is this concept of other? Now, for example, we think about our culture and their culture. Now, what is this other? That has to be understood. So our view of the world is created by our cultural modes. Now, what are these cultural modes? These modes are the essential or characteristic customs and conventions of a society or community that we need to understand. Cultural modes means what? They are the essential or characteristic customs and conventions of a given society or a given community. And our worldview is created by our cultural modes. For example, you belong to a particular community. So your views are created by the belief system of that community. You belong to a particular religion. You belong to a particular nation. You belong to a particular region. Now, for example, yesterday I was reading an article on the perception of Tamil Nadu, people of Tamil Nadu, or Tamil Nadu we can say, by Punjabis. lady, a Tamil lady who married a Punjabi man, wrote that article. Now, Punjabis, wonder how the South Indians can manage the light breakfast, like, idli, etc. So that is their perspective, because they wonder from that perspective. Because Punjabi generally go for, a very heavy breakfast, five parathas and a glass full of, a big glass full of lassi and all. So that is their breakfast. So they wonder how these South Indian people can manage. And one more thing, they think that South Indians are not fair in color, in terms of complexion. So this is their cultural perception. Now, even we people, those who eat bhakris and this polis, etc., bhaji bhakri, we say, bhaji poli, many times we think about South Indians, how do they manage with rice? So what am I trying to explain here is that our view of the world is created by our cultural modes. Is that clear? So those outside our culture who don't share our modes are seen as the other. For example, South Indians become the other for us. Or Thai people become the other for us. Chinese people become the other for us because they don't share our cultural modes. Now, I had come across an article about the Thai people. They go for the chutney of, these red ants. They eat red ants. And they prepare chutney of it. Now, for us, it may be a matter of surprise, a matter of shock. And therefore, that makes us think that they are the other, because our ways, our perception is different. Within Maharashtra as well, again, we have these notions of the other in terms of caste, in terms of religion, in terms of language. Okay, that we talk, that we grow in. So this is created by our cultural modes. And this particular approach leads to misunderstanding and prejudice. Just now I mentioned that Punjabi people think that, South Indians are not fair and all. So this is a kind of misunderstanding. And there was, this discussion was going on Quora Digest. And the South Indians answered that it is the South Indian, South India that provided dream girl to the Bollywood. For example, Hema Malini. Hema Malini belonged to Tamil Nadu, and she was known as a dream girl, a beautiful actress who dominated, who was the superstar of her period. Vaijayanti Mala also belongs to Tamil Nadu. So this is how they present their own side. Means it can create misunderstanding and prejudice. Further, identity is a social construction. Okay, identity that we understood is a social construction. We were talking about, this creation of identity. Some people are the other for us. And then even our own identity is determined by the society that we belong to. Our culture defines social roles for individuals in a society. And these roles are called subject positions. And every person has multiple subject positions within their culture. A same person can be what we call a father, then a same person can be somebody's son, somebody's husband, somebody's what we call brother or sister, somebody's wife. So every person has multiple subject positions within their culture. And our identity is shaped by our culture's expectations that we need to understand. Yes, our role is determined by our culture, and our identity is shaped by our culture's expectations for that particular role, a subject position. As a father, how should one behave? How one should behave? As a brother, how one should behave, as a son, as a wife, or as a daughter, how one should behave. So these are cultural expectations. So our identity is shaped by our culture's expectations. And it is shaped by a tension between our own ideas, which are culturally influenced. So you can bring back the what you call discussion of Sigmund Freud, your ego and superego. Your superego is culturally influenced. Okay, so our ideas are culturally influenced, and the way our culture defines our roles. So there is always a tension between that. Therefore, many times conflicts, individual conflicts or social conflicts arise. Next, beliefs are based on perception of reality. Now, whatever we believe, whatever we think, our thinking, our beliefs are based on how we perceive the reality. These beliefs are drawn from a culture's view of reality. What our culture believes, whatever, you know, our culture takes at reality is the reality for us. Okay, so if our culture creates the meaning of reality, then our beliefs are also created. So when we pursue other culture through the lens of our beliefs, our culture, then we are seeing them as the author that we need to understand. That is not objective, that is subjective perception. Because we think from the perspective of our culture. I have seen, you know, many WhatsApp videos, etc., shared by the people. And, you know, they blame Chinese people. They blame some other people because of their eating habits. Now, we look at them from our perspective, from the lens of our beliefs. Therefore, we have that notion of the other. So, to understand a culture, you should try to look at them through the lens of their beliefs, not from our beliefs. And we need to examine how those beliefs were created. So as a scholar, I'm saying, and not an, as an individual, not as an ordinary individual, but when you want to understand others' culture, for example, we talk about Northeast in India, Northeast people, such as people from Manipur, people from Meghalaya, Tripura, Sikkim, okay, Nagaland, etc. They too become others. No, we generally call them Chinese people, okay, because of their physical structure. Although they are Indians, they are known by China, they are known as Chinese because of our lens, you know, our lens of looking, we can say, a lens of beliefs. Generally, we think that Chinese people have got short nose and all, short height, and their eyes are small. All these, you know, factors, physical attributes, make us believe that. But what I said, we have to think from the lens of their perspective as a scholar. Further, society is marked by a struggle for power. There is always, you know, we talk about conflicts, we talk about protests, we talk about riots. Why does it happen? Why do people fight in the name of caste, in the name of religion, in the name of language? There is a conflict between Karnataka and Maharashtra, because of the border. You might be knowing that. Belgaum, it is a disputed area. There's a conflict between Pakistan and India because of Kashmir, Jammu Kashmir. Okay, there is a conflict between even, you know, Bangladesh and India to some extent. There is a conflict within different groups in India in terms of religion, in terms of other aspects. So you might be knowing, in Mumbai, Shiv Sena emerged as a political party because of the interest of Marathi people. Initially, it emerged as a political party taking favor of Marathi people and opposing South Indians, especially Tamil people initially. Later, it started opposing Gujaratis and then North Indians. Now it doesn't oppose anything at all. So that is a different issue. So this is how things become, you know, prominent. So this power relationship often leads to the powerful shaping what is right. For example, in India, we think so in terms of minority and majority. And the majority in politics generally think that they are right, whereas minorities do have their own perceptions. And the other is, you know, defined by the those who are in power. So this leads to social inequality and a struggle for equality. I said, no, it is perceptional that we need to understand. So we have radical multiculturalism that suggests if we have radical multiculturalism, it suggests that the only way to end this inequality is to work towards the deconstruction of the other. This is radical, actually. Means there should not be anyone who is other. Everything should become homogeneous, but that cannot happen. So this is the other model as a method, no? Radical multiculturalism model, we can say, which wants to deconstruct the notion of the other itself. So this becomes a method of social or cultural understanding, but that is really very radical, as because we believe in what we call diversity, and everything is bound to be like that only. Further, cultural codes create identities for the creator and the receiver. Sometimes, suppose I belong to the group which has the power, which is in power. So it is I who decide the identity of the other as well. Means I am the creator of the identity of the other person. I call somebody by some name. For example, I must have quoted the poem by V.S. Kumar. He says, going by my passport, they call me Indian abroad. Going by my passport, they call me Indian abroad. In my own land, I don't know who I am. Okay. Then to the British, I am a oak. To the Americans, I am a minus red. To the Australian, something, you know, I don't remember the terms now. I'm colored or something. To the South Africans, etc. So internationally as well, we have a different identity. In America, we are called minus red Indians. In Britain, we are colored people or wogs. In Australia as well, there is a kind of, you know, prejudice against us. And then he further talks about India. Beyond the Vindhyas, I am a Saudi. Saudi means a South Indian. Vindhya regions, you know, mountains. Beyond the Vindhyas means in north side. For example, Maharashtra, then Madhya Pradesh, UP, Punjab, etc. South Indians are known as Saudi or a Malayali, or a Madrasi. All South Indians earlier were called Madrasis. Now the things have changed because of the media and all. But earlier, people would know them as Madrasis only or Southies. Means whether they belong to Karnataka, Tamil Nadu, or Kerala, or Andhra Pradesh, irrespective of the region, all of them are called Saudi or what I said, Madrasi. Okay. Beyond the Vindhyas, I am a Saudi or Madrasi. And in Madras, again he says, now Chennai, I am a Malayali. Look how this identity changes. In Madras, I am a Malayali. Okay, further he says, to the Muslims, I am a Hindu. Muslims know me just as a Hindu. And to the Hindus, I am a Brahmin or some other caste name. So you understand it, how identity is created. So it is a fluctuating phenomena. So cultural codes are the ways in which a culture communicates, shares meaning in terms of language, then advertising, laws, trends. Now you come across the advertisings of cosmetics, and in those advertisements, fair skin is shown as the mark of beauty. But does it mean that all African people are ugly then? Does it mean that all those who do not have fair skin are ugly people? So this is how No, identity is created and received. The creator of the cultural code is creating a target audience for who receive the code, who they want to receive it, and how they want to use it, them to use it. Now, you must have come across that advertisement of Shah Rukh Khan, Fair and Handsome, in which we come across a wrestler, a pahlwan, and he uses some kind of cream. And Shah Rukh Khan comes and says, "Oh, pahlwan, मर्द होकर लड़कियों का क्रीम, ओके, एंड दैट इज सेज कल तू लहंगा पहनेगा, लिपस्टिक लगाएगा, सो ही इमेजिन दैट पहलवान स्टार्ट्स इमेजिनिंग ही द रिसीवर, दिस आइडेंटिटी इज इम्पोज बाय द एडवर्टाइजिंग एजेंसी ऑन द मैन स्टार्ट थिंकिंग दैट इफ ही यूजेज दैट क्रीम ही विल बिकम फेमिनाइन, सो मर्द होकर लड़कियों का क्रीम, लड़कियों वाला क्रीम, कल लहंगा पहनेगा, so he starts that man is shown in lehenga and then the man puts on that lipstick and all. So this is how what we call the receive the creator of the identity creates, and the receiver is made to behave accordingly. So in creating the code, the creator is demonstrating shaping her or his own identity, and the receiver also shapes his or her identity by the way they respond to or use this code. Okay, so he starts using what we call that fair and handsome, and then he appears handsome. That is shown later. So this is how advertisements work. This is how language work. This is how laws even are created. This is how trends are created. Sometimes we are made to wear this kind of trousers. Sometimes we are made to create use that kind of trousers. So this is how the things are created and received. So the creator and receiver also are influencing each other's identity through their interaction. I just gave you the example of the advertisement. So these are the principles that we need to understand that cultural studies, uses while studying different aspects of culture, the way the social meaning is created.